سو بتعرفوا انا اسمي باسكال زوفي ام تايب ديزاينر بحكي شوي عربي على انجليزي على لبناني في حدا هون ما بيعرف عربي
You don't
speak Arabic You don't speak Arabic okay so we'll stick to English so my talk today is going to be about the latest technology in Arabic typefaces and how the new technology is reshaping the design aspect and the technological aspect of the industry. Just quickly, what you're seeing now, it's our new logo that's going to be present when the new website is going to be released, hopefully in the coming months. You see that in our old logo, we only had an Arabic 29 حرف. And the new logo, you see that there's the 2 and 9, they are in the Indic and in the Arabic figures, just to state that we are becoming more multilingual and multinational and not only focused on the Arabic. Are you hearing me well?
Yes.
So what we do is, basically, for now, we do Arabic and Latin multilingual typefaces. What you see here is a selection of our fonts. There's different styles and different approaches for every typeface, depending on the need. Our two biggest type family, this is one of them, is Bukra, and it has 94 styles. It comes from condensed to white. I spoke about Bukra in Dubai 2 years ago, but today I want to speak about Zared, which it's our latest superfamily. And it has different styles included within the type family, inspired from calligraphy. Under the topic of nostalgia in this Design Week edition, what I will do at the talk is I will try to go back and forth between calligraphic notions about Arabic type or Arabic calligraphy and the like contemporary typefaces. Focusing on the font that I'm going to speak about, which is called Zared. So, Zared superfamily is made now of five subfamilies. There's the Sans, the Slab, the Serif, the Text, the Display, and there's others coming later in the year and next year. The idea is that to give the graphic designers a wide variety of styles for them to be able to use them in different hierarchies or layout designs and allow them to have different voices for their design without the need of switching typefaces. And also this typeface of course supports Arabic and Latin, so for any bilingual publication in the Middle East you are set. This is somehow the system how it is now, and you see that the Sans and the Slab are like low contrast, they're more like geometric, humanistic, while the Serif ones, they are more calligraphic, they're more high contrast calligraphic, etc. So, if you put all the, let's take an example of the Latin, so here you see all the difference. The Sans, and then you have the Slab Serif, the Serif, the Text, and the Display. And you see that there are different categories of serifs based on Latin classification. And also you see the letter, how it's overlapped, but then you notice that every font is actually redrawn. It's not like only small tweaks, it's actually like a redrawn of the font. If you go to the Arabic also, it really shows the diversity. The screen is not giving a good representation of the typefaces, but hopefully you can imagine it in your mind. Remove all the pixel cut shapes and make them nice and and smooth. So, as we know in Arabic, we have three systems in calligraphy, which are Nizam al-Naqat, Nizam al-Tashabuh, and Nizam al-Da'ira, which is the circle system, the dot system, and the similarity system. And these were done by Ibn Uqla decades, centuries ago, based on his own analysis of the different styles and determine the proportions and the structures. When it comes to modern typefaces, it's quite hard to be able to create a modern typeface and at the same time stay as strictly or as true to the calligraphic rules and regulations, because at the end maybe they don't fit together. And with here I'm going to give you a quick like preview of how what goes into the mind of the type designer while he's designing an Arabic typeface and has a notion of how it should be calligraphically. So here you see the alif letter and the circle, and then here we see the lam and the dot, just to see the difference that is happening between the contrast that's happening between the starting point of the horizontal of the vertical pen stroke, and to see the different outline changes. And each of them, it changed based on a certain notion. So for example, the latest Zaret display, you would see that somehow it's linked to the thulus style, because the thulus is somehow, in the Arabic calligraphy, it was mostly used for headlines, for important documents, mostly as display typeface. It has very elegant, tall structures. It has this very sharp starting point. Whereas at the Zaret text and Zaret mastery, we are more relying on the nasakh approach for the base of it. And this you can see also from the starting point of the pen stroke and other stuff. When it goes to the sans and to slab, they become a bit more neutral, more geometric. They become a bit more like hybrid kind of fonts, like they inspire from like geometric fonts, like Kufic geometric structures, mixed with the notion of how a modern new nasakh would be, and then mix them together. And while you are drawing the type and while you're seeing them in your mind, your mind is somehow trying to find a nice balance for the typeface that works for these two approaches. And what I'm trying to tell you is that for a modern type designer, it's a bit tricky for it to describe exactly what a typeface is based on. It wouldn't be purely based on nasakh, or purely based on a Kufic structure, or purely based on a thulus structure. Most probably, or basically what I'm working on lately, and what we're working on at Material Letters, is the notion that we inspire from all the different styles, or mainly one or two styles, and then we redraw them in a modern way to make our typefaces feel contemporary, feel nowadays, that fit with the modern trends and approaches in the Middle Eastern graphic design community. All the notions of what is new, what is... And we cannot stick strictly to the calligraphic approaches, because then we are stuck to a certain style that maybe somehow gives a traditional feel to the typeface. So there's always this balance. So we need to know the calligraphy, inspire from it, but at the same time, we have to try to give it a new feel and look to make it live in our modern day life. And this task actually is not easy, because you need to know both words very well, and then you can create something new in between. And this is somehow what I'm trying to show you in this first section of the talk. So on top you see all the different alifs of Zaret, and down you see some of the styles based on the dot system. So the Ruka, the Diwani, the Thulus, and Asaf, and the Kufi. The Kufic styles, they don't have any determined systems like the cursive fonts styles, because it's an older script and it wasn't as well documented, or really, there wasn't really some documented systems to it. So if you see, this is the alif that you see here of Zaret display, that really is inspired from the alif of the thulus, and all the others, the text and the salif, they are like a hybrid of the nasakh here that you see here, maybe one of these kufis. And then when it comes to the sans and the salif, slab, it's more like the Kufic. And you can see that if you don't see the lower part, you might think that these fonts were designed from scratch or without any notion of calligraphy. But if you look deeper into it, you will know that there was a very strong back thought approach to how these fonts should be designed and how would they match perfectly the Latin. And the other task is how to match the Arabic and the Latin. And we decided to make, for example, for the slab, Latin, a more geometric, monolinear kind of Arabic, like Kufic Nasaf, or what we say hybrids. For the sans and the serif, it was more like a new Nasaf, like a new Nasaf version of a Nasaf. For the text, it's more Nasaf purely somehow, but more also modernized, but has more calligraphic aspect. And the display was more thulos, with a bit of a Nasaf flavor to it. So here we have the three systems that we spoke about. The Nizam al-Dahira, Nizam al-Naqat, and Nizam al-Tashabuh. And I'm going to compare few letters based on the system and letters that are from the Zarat family. Just to show you that some letters, they somehow fit into the calligraphic rules, but some others completely not. And why is that? Because we are doing some design decisions about the style phase. So these are the Aleph and the Ba of Zarat display, and these are the Aleph and the Ba from a traditional thulos calligraphic approach. You can see that here it says that there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 dots that make the Aleph, and here also there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 dots that make the Aleph. So the Aleph fits perfectly within the rules and regulations of the... When it comes to the Ba, it works at the width, so the width of the Ba is the same as the height of the Aleph. But you will notice that the Ba here is not as much inclined as in the ortholos. It's maybe a bit more sitting on the baseline or on the base of our font to make it more aligned with all the overall design approach of the typeface. So you see here that there's one dot that should be lifted, and here it doesn't exist. And this is a design decision that I took, and I decided to keep the same proportion of the width, but maybe remove the element of the inclination, because this is how I want it to be in this typeface, or how this typeface works as a whole. Another example is the Ha and the Ayn. You will see that somehow they still fit somehow on the same approach, but when you look at the eyes of the Ayn and the Ha, at the brow of the Ha, they are somehow a bit more open. They have a more open approach for the eyes. And this is another design decision taken, because in all of the Zarat type family, all the counters, they are a bit more open compared to the calligraphic traditional fonts. And here, if you go to the scene at the side, you see the big change happened. And you see here that the Al mount of the Saad and the T's of the scene compared to the bowl, now they are a bit more balanced and less linked to the calligraphic approach, which is very much bigger bowls and smaller pools. So I'm not going to go more in detail. Maybe this is very technical and very... here it also shows the calf and the wow. And you see here drastically how the heads of the wow and the calf, they become really bigger. All of these decisions were taken to make the type family work as a system, Arabic Latin, to make it work in small and big size, to make it work in different weights, to make it work in different styles. Here you see the wow in Nasr, the wow in Thulos, and this is the wow in Zarat display. And you see that somehow we keep the same pen stroke structure, so we keep the same understanding of the pen structure, so the typeface has the humanist calligraphic approach to it. So it's still linked to the handwritten approach. We didn't break away from the writing technique. But the proportions of the head to the tail, the proportions of the white space to the black space, they are a bit changed to allow for this modern approach to happen. Here you can see the Ta, it somehow keeps this starting pen stroke, the same ending approach, but then the proportions are a bit changed. And then here you see different weights and style. And the calligraphic system, it doesn't really work for a new modern family that has, for example, eight weights from thin to black. Because maybe what works on the black might not work on the thin, based on the dot system or based on the circle system. And these are part of the challenges that you want to approach also as a modern type designer. If you put all the wows, so before we were just comparing the wows of Zaret display, and here we see the wows of all the type family, and you see that they somehow share the same proportions, the same approach to design, but each one of them is slightly different, either if it is based on thulos or nesef or kufic or in between all of these structures. And if you put the outlines all above together, you notice that each one of them can be a different typeface. But because they are built all together based on the same approach or the same skeleton, they work also as a big system. And this makes a big change for the type designer and for the graphic designer using the type family as a whole system in their projects. And this is the aim of the typeface. The other point, after speaking about the calligraphic approaches, after saying that we need to aspire for calligraphy but somehow drift away from it a bit, and then we have to match it with certain other approaches. And the Latin is basically much more now standardized. There's a baseline, ascended, descended, excite. It's very clear, it's very to the point. You need to make your font fit into these proportions. When it comes to the Arabic, it gets a bit more complicated because we still need to fit our Arabic within these guidelines, with these typographic guidelines. But we don't want to Latinize it, or we don't want to make it so stiff or make it so rigid to fit with the Latin. So we need to keep it a bit Arabic. So we notice that in the Arabic it becomes a bit more variable. There's more lines that you don't see on the screen. So instead of the X height, we have tooth height, eye height, album heights, etc. For the medial heights of the letter. For the baseline, we have the base, and we have the base thickness, where the letters need to link. Then we have the earth and sky. So arid will sama. And all is sama lal ascenders, will arid lal descenders. Will kaid lal baseline. These terms are coming from calligraphy. But it's somehow reinvented typographically to make this Arabic typographic guidelines. If you want to read more about this topic, there is an article on the blog, you can really read about it, just to compare these two. But the main idea is that we are trying as much as possible to take all the notions that are coming from the hand calligraphic structures, but we need to change them to its typographical approach. And here you can see all the different styles. So here we have the sans, the slab, the serif, the text, and the display. And you see that how most of them, they stick to the same proportions, but also every one of them is different by its design. And you can see also the harmonious design between the Arabic and the Latin. So they also work perfectly together. They have the same contrast, the same proportions, the same approach. But the Arabic is truly Arabic, and the Latin is truly Latin. And no script is sacrificed for the sake of the other. So the Arabic is not Latinized, or the Latin is Arabized. Each script is totally respected, but somehow when you put them together, they work, because they have the same design approach. But they are completely two different scripts. The last system, so what we were discussing before, they were mostly the dot system and the circle systems and how we are making them work typographically. And the last system is Nizam al-Tashabuh, which is the similarity system. So there is similar elements, pen strokes or different structures, letter structures that are shared by different letters. For example, the belly of the Ain and the Ha, or the tail of the Waw and the Ra, or the bowl of the Sin and the Saad, etc. And I'm going to show you the character set of Zaret display. What you see in gray are only the letters that are actually drawn outlines. All what you see in white they are only components from these letters. So this really shows how the Nizam al-Tashabuh, or what we call like working on pen strokes or components, we create some kind of pen elements or structures, and we use them for the right letter they should be. So for example, we draw the ball of the Noor, and then this same ball it will be used for the Noor, for the Sad, for the Seen, etc. We can draw the almond shape, and we can use it for the Sad, and for the Dhamma, and for the Dal, and the Dhat. We can draw the tail of the Ra and the Waw, and we can use it for the Ra and the Waw and the Zain, etc. So we can use the same approach typographically, or type design. So here you can see the basic set, which are around 250 plus or minus. It only covers from the Alif to Ya and all different form. And then you see that also we tend to create as much as possible ligatures and stylistic sets and alternates to the typeface to somehow get it as close as possible to calligraphy. Also that this makes it more legible for reading, it makes it more interesting. And actually the ligature sets, they are 4 or 5 times the basic Arabic set. So for example, Zarin display, it has around 1,800 glyphs in it, letters, and the basics, also the Latin, but the basic sets are maybe like 300, 400, but then the other 1,000 is ligatures and stylistic sets and alternates. And we are doing all of this extra effort, and we're doing all of these extra glyphs to make the font more true to its calligraphic origins. And to give you a bit more visual interpretation, so for example, this is the Ayn of the letter Ha, and you can see that this is drawn outlines. And in the background, you can see all the different letters and the ligatures that use the same component. Here you can see the tail of the meme, for example, only this shape. The tail of the meme, and also all different. Again, sorry, the screen is not being true to what it should be showing you, but for example, there's the Sad meme ligature, Ha meme ligature, Lam meme ligature, meme ligature. All the ligatures that end with the meme find a position. They are sharing the same tail, which is next to. Here we have the teeth of the seam, the snail, taba al seam. And also you see that it's shared between the seam and the sheen. All the ligatures that are seen, yeah, seen, seen meme, seen ha, all the other one, they share the same starting point of the seam. So we draw it once, we fix it, and then we use it for different elements. And here's the element of the Sad, again the same story. So enough of going back and forth between calligraphy and typography, and I want to go back to the story of why Zarid. And the word Zarid comes, you know what Zarid means in Arabic? It means strong, it means the determined, strong, reliable characteristic, right? And the starting point of Zarid, it was initially designed in 2009 for Emirates Today newspaper in Dubai. And I was commissioned to design the headlines typeface for the newspaper. And the briefing was that you want something very strong and very serious for our magazine, and we need to be distinguished between all the other Middle Eastern newspapers. And after I made some research, which I'm going to show you now a brief take on the research, we decided at the end to make the font based on the Mastari Nasakh, which is the Nasakh which is based on the ruler. Mastari comes from Mastara, which is the ruler. And we made a very bold, strong, very stiff typeface with very strong edges and forms. And this was used for the newspaper. So these are images of the newspaper in 2009. And the newspaper, it started in 2005 with a very generic kind of font, but then in 2008 it changed And then when they changed the typeface and also they changed the layout, it gave a completely different modern look to the newspaper. And suddenly it became like one of the most important newspapers in the Dubai, in the UAE. And just saying that, that people maybe don't know the importance of typefaces, the importance of typography, but actually just a change of a typeface, especially for a newspaper which is all based on type, it gives a complete image change for the newspaper. So this is again the font. So the story is that this is how it was before the newspaper, before we did the font for it. And you see that they were using the very standard kind of Arabic. It's also Masri, but it has also problems. You can see that the letters are not connected, or the contrast maybe is very extreme. The baseline is very thick, but the letters are not very well drawn. They are very thinner. And this is in 2007, and this is in 2008, when they changed the typeface, and they changed the layout. And you can see a big jump in the feel and approach of the newspaper. And they used the font. The font was commissioned to the newspaper for 5 years. So they used it from 2008 until 2013. And while the font was in use, other newspapers, they were starting to commission us again to make similar kind of fonts that also give this feel and image. And after a while, most of them were using this kind of typefaces. And after 5 years, they changed again to a different typeface, which is more like, as you see here now, which is more like a sans serif, more like what we spoke about, these like more monochromatic, maybe they are like hybrid fonts between Kufi and Nasr, what we call, I don't know what is the proper term for these fonts, but they are called hybrids. And once the rights of the font came back to Tottenham Letters, we were able to develop it. So we were sad that they stopped using it for the newspaper, but we were happy that it came back to us and now we can make it as a system. And analyzing what was happening in the newspaper industry, and not only in the newspaper industry, but all the publishing industry back in 2010, 2015, to whatever, we are noticing that there's always a shift between what is nasakh and what calligraphic nasakh, what is nasakh, and what is like more geometric kufic fonts or the hybrids in between. And we said, why don't we take back this font and we create this big family that creates, that gives all different styles and all different options for the any kind of publication or designer to use in their layouts. Before I speak about that, I want to compare, since we are in Lebanon and we're speaking about nostalgia, and I want to go through a quick history about a more established, older newspaper, which is Al-Nahar. As we know, it's one of the first maybe newspapers in the Middle East. And I'm going to go through the years from the 60s. I couldn't find older archival photos. It started in 1933, Al-Nahar. And I know that previously when they started, actually they were using a thulus handwritten type or calligraph type for the headlines and nasr for the copy text. But I don't have any images for that. What I have is from the 60s until now. What was interesting before the computer, so this was before the computer, before set type for digital. And what was really interesting, that all the headlines were written by a calligrapher. Every day there was a calligrapher, or maybe several calligraphers sitting in the newspaper, and they will get the headlines from the editors or from the writers, and they will actually have to write down by hand the titles, and they will give them back to the newspaper, and they will put them. So this was mostly hand drawn, and you notice that most of it were using the Nasr style, and before it was more the Nasr, more the calligraphic Nasr, with more the calligraphic cursive kind of baseline. And then as we go through the years, it's becoming more the Mastani Nasr. So the calligrapher would put actually a ruler to define the width and the height and how many headlines he can fit in a certain assigned space. And then he will draw the pen based on a ruler, and then all the baseline will become stiff. And you would see how it's changing and how it's coming from here. It's a big change, and here you see that it's still here handwritten, and here you see that it's still handwritten, but it's more like a really now mastery type, mastery nasr, it's more straight. And then later you can see that they switch to a font, which is also a nasr. At the same time, technically, we don't have time now to speak about it, but at the same time, there was the typewriter being happening, the Arabic typewriter started happening, and they made the simplified Arabic version to fit on the keyboard. And also there was Linotype doing Ya'ut and other typefaces, also simplified Arabic, so they cut the character set to make it fit on the keyboard. For example, the initial form of the letter will be the initial and the medial, and the final form will serve as the final and isolated. And they adopted the system of the Mastari Nasr and also the reduced character set. So this also came with technology change. And you also notice that, again, it doesn't show on the screen, but you will notice that the price also is changing. And here in the corner, there is a circle. And when it started, it was 5 Eruj, but then started 25 Eruj. بعدين طلت 25 بعدين صارت 3 ليرات بعدين صارت 25 ليرة بعدين صارت 52 ليرة وبعدين 1000 اللي هي so and also you see that the masthead was changing, the logo of Nahar. So the font also was changing with the change of the trends and of the economicals, whatever it is happening. So here clearly you see that now it's really Nasr Mastari, and for the past like since the 90s somehow until lately, most of the newspapers who are still using the Nasr, they are somehow doing it in Nasr Mastari. And based on this research, I decided to make the headline fonts for Emirate Al-Mun based on the Mastari Nasr, but give it a very strong and contemporary feel to it. Just to continue quickly, now it shows the latest, so at 2010-2011, the newspaper changed. So this was the font that they used digitally in like, I think, 2000s. Maybe late 90s to 2000s. And then later they commissioned Nadine Shaheen from Monotype to do a also custom font for the headlines, and also honoring the assassination of Jamal. And it was part of the rebrand of the newspaper. You see that also the masthead became bigger, and it became, so again, a new typeface, a stronger look, very strong Mastari Nasr again. That works with a new, cleaner layout for the newspaper. And also, they started also coupling it with another font, which is more like these Kufic hybrids, whatever you want to call them. And this reinforces the idea that now we need a system that serves all these styles. And just quickly, and then now they are putting less and less effort on the print and trying to give more importance to the web, mobile, tablets, because you know that we are moving into the new media, screen-based, bit by bit the print issues will be less and less, and now they're trying to make subscriptions. And this gets us to the topic that maybe in coming years most of us will stop buying maybe the print edition, and all of us will be looking at our screens. And for this, I'm going to go back to Zarit now and tell you that what is interesting about this topic is that now there's a new technology at the typefaces called variable fonts. And variable fonts, they allow you to change different styles, different weights, with the same font. So this is what the new technology is called, variable font. So previously, we used to have a 1.5 for every weight and 1.5 for every style. And since 2 years, 3 years now, it's becoming a bit, more supported, the font, the variable font technology. And this year, actually, the Arabic script is becoming a bit more supported. And now we're starting to make our fonts in variable fonts. And the idea is that because everything is moving digitally, everything is moving to the screen and to changing resolution and changing widths. Also, so we speak about responsive designs for the website, mobile, and also we need somehow responsive typefaces to work with these responsive designs. And Zarit type family is going to be variable font. For now, it's only going to be between the weights, so that. But maybe in the future, maybe it become more also versatile. So what you're seeing here is the Latin Zarit, and you can see the different approach to the letters, the different serifs, and the contrast, and the proportions. And also it goes back to the idea that it's a system with different styles, with different feel to it, but they all fit under the same skeleton. When it comes to the Arabic, again, I want to go back to the Aleph, and I want to compare the heads of the Aleph. So only from this small part of the lamb, it says a lot about the font. And it says that on the slab and the sans, we are more going geometric, we're going hybrid, we're going low contrast. And the serif, we're going neo-nasakh, or like a new nasakh. And it's medium contrast, and in the text we are going neo-nasakh but with high contrast, so you see that it's the contrast is being more extreme. Also, it's more in line with calligraphy, so the shape of the starting pen stroke is more visible than the serif. And then the latest is the display, which is the extreme contrast, and then also based on the thullus. Now, again, we speak again about calligraphy, and I'm just trying to give a notion that for the Arabic, we don't have really determined typographic notions as we have for the Latin, which is serif, non-serif, and at the serif we have slab, modern, old style, all the different techniques. In Arabic, we don't have this established. And now, while working on this type system and other future type systems, I had to force myself to somehow give some kind of definition for each of these Arabic styles that are accompanied by these Latin styles. And this is what I'm up with myself. Maybe another art type designer will make a different kind of definitions or determinations or decisions. So, it's just to say that for the Arabic type design or typography community, it's a bit more free, which is actually a good point. The negative point is that until now, there's not a set rule and regulations for everyone to follow equally, like it is in the Latin. So there's the cons and pros, but I think the cons are more to the pros are more to the than the cons, because it gives us freedom and gives us liberty for every type designer to give a certain new approach to this typeface or another typeface. Maybe in a few decades, at some point, it will be standardized, but until now, it's not. So again, we see here the Zarit superfamily, and you see that the beginning was the Zarit in 2014, when the newspaper stopped using it, and then in 2017, it was called Zarit Serif, because it was the idea that we want to grow it. And then in 2018, we did Zarit Sans, So we said, what is the most needed version of this typeface? And of course, it needs a sense. Like, it's the most common style that we need to create. So after the serif, we did the sans. And then after the sans, we did the text version, which is more the text version of the serif, which makes it much more legible and small sizes for publication editorials. And then we did the slab, which is this style which is between the sans and the very geometric approach of a typeface. And then lastly, what was published a few weeks back is a display, which is like the really beautiful big display typeface based on the Thilos. And future styles are coming, like stencils, and maybe mono or duo, Arabic Latin, and other styles. So this is an overview of the type family. This is the sans, comparing only the wow and the moon. So this is the sans, the slab. So it says neo-nasakh Arabic and sans-serif Latin. It says hybrid kufic, simplified nasakh for the Arabic and slab serif for the Latin. Mastery nasakh for the Arabic and serif for the Latin. Neo-nasakh for the Arabic and serif for the Latin. And the display is like a hybrid thulus neo-nasakh for the Arabic and a modern serif for the Latin. And this is actually the main features that distinguish Zared superfamily from maybe other Arabic typefaces that are present in the market. And we hope that this makes a big, like an impact on the design community in the Middle East. Just an example, just to make a hypothetical approach that Al-Nahar Premium is now this online service that you subscribe for, and you can access more articles online. And I'm only setting the fonts of the headlines using Zared. So you see the headline is Zared Serif, and here all of them is Zared Serif. And here you see that we kept Zared Serif for the headline, but we use Zared Sans for the sub-headlines, and we use Zared Text for the text. And here maybe we use the slab for the headlines, and we use the sans for the sub-headlines and for the text. Or what about using the sans and the slab together? Or what about using the display and the sans? And you see that all of these options are valid, and each one of them gives you a feel only by changing the font. And this gives you more like elegance. Maybe Zared display would be more like fashion, culture, whatever. Maybe the serif will give you more seriousness, politics. But this is just a quick overview that by only changing the typeface, nothing else, you are changing the whole image that you are giving. And this is all now coming from the same type family, which we are happy to share with you. And what about moving from laptop to a mobile resolution? Do we keep the same font size or reduce the font size? Or do we keep the same weight? And this is what we come back to the variable fonts. And now I'm going to switch to another screen to show you a bit how the variable fonts work. So this is a quick screen view of a variable font of the sans. But I'm going actually to go inside the glyph font system now and show you a bit of the inside stuff of a variable font. So here you are seeing the letter A. Let's take the kaf since we are speaking about Arabic. Down here you are seeing all different assigned weights. You see here the masters, which are the thin and the black. And up here you have a slider that says weight. Doesn't show here much on the screen, but if I move the slider, you can see that the letter is moving by weight. This is a weight axis in this variable font. And now we can generate a font So now we have 8 different styles at the traditional font. That is, every style is any font. But now we can generate one font that has all of these styles in it, and you have an access that you can play with it manually, or you can assign to a website or to a animation or script that if we change resolution between desktop and mobile, move the access, move the weight access from 10 to 50, or move, if we have a weight access, move the weight access, whatever it is, if we're doing a certain kind of animation. So the font becomes also responsive to the needs of the screen or to the needs of whatever you need. Also, it's going to be for print resolutions, and in the Adobe system and the Adobe applications, you will see now that if you have a variable font, you have a custom node where the styles is, and you can click on the custom node and you can change with it. Another font that we're working on as a, this is a bigger, so Bukra, this is a bigger system, and now we're also working on it as a variable font. And you can see that here it has a weight and a width axis. It has two axes, so it has the width and the weight. And you can see that I can change the weight. Except it's not working now, but sorry, I did something. So you can see up here, up, let me make this bigger. So these are example letters, only the meme and the kaf for the Arabic, and the A and the letter, and you can see that you can change widths, and you can change weight. And this is going to be only one font. And it has, this type family has 6 masters instead of 2 compared to Zaret. And it allows you to have endless amount of instances or of between and the width axis and the weight axis. And now I'm going to switch to another browser. This is now back to Zaret. And this is an online browser app done by Dynamo, the Arati Foundry. They did this Dynamo darkroom only to test the variable fonts. So here I dropped all the different variable fonts of Zaret. So here we have Zaret Display, Zaret Text, Zaret Serif, Zaret Slab, and Zaret Sans. And here you can see that there is a weight axis. And if I play with the weight axis, the font directly changes. I can still see the styles here if I want to select any assigned style. But I can also go anywhere in between these styles. And now this browser, it allows you to make like animations. This is just one of the examples to make animations with the font. Another example is to use it differently, like it can be like a mouse over, or it can be in different resolutions, or it can be that maybe in the future, like it can detect how far is the screen from your eye, and based off on how far is it, is the mobile or the computer from your eye, it can change the size maybe of the font. So we can change the size, and we can change the weight in this font. And Bukra, for example, we can change the size, the weight, and the width. We can change how the animation we want it to be based on here, what we allow to make at this website. And this is only a quick example about how these fonts might be used. And it's still very, in its early time. In the coming years, we're going to know more the possibilities of variable fonts. And also the Arabic will be more supported. Sadly, now the Arabic is only supported on browsers. It's not supported yet by Adobe applications and other applications, so we cannot use it for print. It can only be used in browsers, but already it's a good usage for all apps and websites that can be used. And just to say that it is animation, but it's still a font, so I can actually type now. I can change the text and type while it is doing so. I can type now typography. It's not a static animation that is not editable. It is still the font itself, but the font itself, it is changing. And this is what's called variable fonts. So here we wrote typography, we can write in Arabic also typography, whatever, we can change the size, all of it. So this is a big preview of it. And just to, before I finish, our new website is coming, and hopefully it will come in the summer, or if not in the fall of 2019. And in the new website, we're very happy to say that it's going to support variable fonts. All of our fonts, or most of them, will be available as variable fonts, Arabic and Latin. And you can test the fonts directly on the website. And you can also purchase a variable font, or you can purchase the traditional styles. And please stay tuned to 21letters.com. And that's it for me now. Thank you.